Today we are discussing what makes LG's brand new 32-inch 6K display unique compared to other 6K displays in the marketplace, as well as why that discussion matters, because this monitor is going to make a lot of sense for people just like you and me. Let's get started. Coming in at $1,999, the LG 32U990A-S appears to be an easy choice. The specs of it sit between the Studio Display and the Pro Display XDR, but the price point, that is another story, because the price point, the feature set, actually might get much more of a direct comparison to the Studio Display and an alternative for that. So whether you're a creative who needs crystal clear display with high pixel density, or you simply just want to reduce your eye strain with its razor sharp text, the display is clearly meant to push well above its weight in terms of features and value for Mac users out there. Inside the box, you get a slim, lightweight 32-inch panel, a two-part aluminum stand, which we'll get into more in just a few minutes, as well as a very, very large 320-watt power supply and a mix of cables, including Thunderbolt 5. Now, the overall build quality is generally acceptable, and I really like the overall aesthetic, even if it's made of plastic that gives off the appearance of brushed metal or aluminum. It's not bad looking. It doesn't feel, I mean, it's definitely not aluminum like the Studio Display or like the Pro Display XDR, but it's gonna be acceptable for most people out there. Now, there's zero branding, it's boxy, and it's very modern looking from any direction that you happen to look at it. Now, there's no mistaking that it's not using Apple level materials, but I don't think it's trying to be Apple either here. It is solid and nothing here feels too fragile, but it doesn't have that over-engineered feeling to it that most Apple products have. The bottom of the stand is aluminum and it's very heavy, which is gonna ground your monitor to your desktop. Now, the second part of the panel is gonna be a navy blue material that gives it a nice texture. I'm not mad at it. It might not be everyone's aesthetic, but it does look nice. Looking at it from the side, it uses a similar mechanism as a Studio Display for hilt, height, and tilt adjustment, which is nice because this option itself is a $400 option on the Studio Display. But one glaring omission from my perspective is that it does not have any cable management features whatsoever. It doesn't even have a hole to pass through the cables, and it feels like a miss on a $2,000 monitor, which I think LG certainly could have accounted for in some way, shape, or form. Now, you're forced to drape everything around the stand or hide it in like a monitor stand like I'm using here, depending on your level of OCD, which my level of OCD is usually pretty bad, but it may or may not be a deal breaker for you. You let me know what you think about that down below. Once you have everything assembled, the ergonomics is probably the strongest selling point of this monitor, and LG knows that. You get tilt from -5 to +20 degrees, you get height adjustment up to 110 millimeters, and full rotation into portrait mode, which you'll have to pull out the bottom of it while you're rotating it. I do wish it went down just a little bit more because in my current desk setup, I want to hide the cables, and it just leaves the cable mess a little bit more evident. There is zero swivel, and the height adjustments are not as buttery smooth as what you'd expect on the Studio Display, but that probably isn't a deal breaker for most of you guys out there. Once you move it once, you maybe not have to move it again. It is VESA compatible at 100 by 100 millimeters, and if you want to mount an arm to it, the four-side slim bezel design looks clean on any desk. Now, the connectivity is very interesting here because it is excellent to say the least. You get one downstream Thunderbolt 5 port that can deliver 96 watts of power to your computer. You're gonna get an upstream Thunderbolt 5 port, which we'll touch on here more in just a minute, as well as two USB-C ports that are USB-C 3.2, Gen 2.2, an HDMI 2.1 port, a DisplayPort 2.1, all built into a KVM switch, which allows you to switch between multiple different inputs at the same time. So you can go from one computer to the next very easily if you're going from a Mac to a PC or to a game system. Now, the panel itself is only 60 hertz, which may limit the application of it. Now, if you are connecting it to a Mac or a compliant Windows computer, you can daisy chain the monitor to a second display, which kind of makes it like a unicorn in this space because the number of pixels that are being pushed here, and genuinely very useful if you're running a multi-monitor workflow. This is gonna save you from having to consume another port on your Mac or on your Thunderbolt dock because the second video monitor signal is supplied by the first monitor. Now, there's a couple of caveats here. You gotta keep in mind that one, you can only daisy chain two of these monitors together. Two, and the refresh rate for the second monitor is gonna be capped at 60 hertz because that's gonna be the display rate for the first monitor. And that's all gonna be driven by the power and bandwidth limitations of Thunderbolt 5. All right, guys, why don't I go ahead and demonstrate one more use case for you. So here I have the LG 32U connected to my MacBook Pro M4 Max. And the Studio Display is daisy chained to this here. So basically I'm running two displays via one Thunderbolt cable to my M4 Max. Now here I have the M4 MacBook Air, which does not have Thunderbolt 5. And we're gonna connect it here to see whether or not it will work. My thought is that it will not, but we're gonna see this in real time. So we are powering on display number one, and display number two is non-functional. So my studio display, I cannot daisy chain it to this display here, the LG, and then connect it to my M4 MacBook Air. If I had a, what else is available in the M4? MacBook Air, Mac Mini, just the MacBook, the MacBook Pro, that would not work. So that is another limitation. If you're thinking about daisy chaining, you gotta make sure that you have a Thunderbolt 5. It will be the only way that works because of the additional bandwidth that's needed by Thunderbolt 5 and daisy chaining. And now you know.
As for the panel itself, LG is using a nano IPS black panel. It's 32 inches, it's 6K, and it's about 224 pixels per inch, slightly above the studio display, which comes in around 218 pixels per inch. The LG panel has 2,000:1 contrast ratio and coverage of 98% DCI-P3 and nearly all of the Adobe RGB color. Brightness is around 450 nits and it supports HDR600. The display itself is not a matte finish, it's a diffused anti-glare coating and it cuts down reflections without needing to go full matte. I like it. I like editing video on it, like editing photos on it. It does come out nice. I do like a glossy screen, I think, more than I like this matte texture, and I definitely like it more than the matte texture on the ProR 27 JCV from Asus. But, you know, depending on what your working environment is, you may or may not like any type of matte texture on your display. You might want the full glossiness because that's how your image or your artwork or whatever you're working on is gonna look best. So it really depends on that. For me, my studio where I'm at right now, I am in a second bedroom that's on the first floor that faces northwest, if I'm not mistaken. So I don't get a ton of sun here in the afternoon. It does get in the wintertime just a little bit, but it's not too bad. And I do control most of the lighting in here as well. So now while it does offer significant connectivity options, there is no integrated camera, and that's okay because the integrated camera on the studio display is hot garbage to say the least. But where this monitor does lack is gonna be the integrated speakers. It generally makes listening to any type of modern music pretty painful because they are abysmal, in my opinion. Some people are gonna say that, you know, you're gonna connect them to an external monitor, you're gonna use headphones or AirPods, and that's okay, but that's just an excuse, in my opinion, for the quality of the speakers. I want to have good speakers on my display that I just paid $2,000 for. I don't think that's actually too much to ask. There is a button in the back of there for the on-screen display controls. Out of the way, you know, it's very easy to use if you use any type of, it's like a jog dial almost. Jog dial, is that what they call it? If I'm wrong, you'll correct me down in the comments below. But the OSD controls are a little cumbersome, but familiar if you've used LG or any other monitor before. In terms of features, this display is compatible with LG Switch software. It's a downloadable first-party calibration and display mode client that allows you to update the firmware, dial in different viewing scenarios, adjust the contrast, all while enabling different keyboard shortcuts for adjusting the volume, brightness. Overall, there is a lot to love about this monitor. First, I believe that it is competitively priced, even though it costs $1,999. It is competitively priced for people who either want or need premium design. They need razor sharp text, high resolution, and it's not gonna cost them an arm and a leg like the Pro Display XDR does cost. The build quality isn't remarkable or even memorable, but good for most people that are out there who are considering this monitor. Many ergonomic features that cost extra on the studio display, they're just simply included with that here, including the matte-like coating on the display itself, making this a compelling studio display alternative. So it really depends on what your workflow is and what you value. For me, I love editing photos, working with documents, and managing my video timeline on the 6K panel. And I probably think that this is the sweet spot. I'm looking over here because this is where the monitor is. I actually think this is the sweet spot for display size and density. I normally have two 27-inch monitors side by side, and they don't quite offer enough in my estimation. I could certainly get by with a 32-inch single panel now, because everything when you're working in like Photoshop, Lightroom, Final Cut, you know, any type of creative studio or creative app that has many different UI controls that are densely, you know, kind of clustered together, this makes it very easy to run it on that monitor. So if you're anything like me, maybe working with 3D modeling, Photoshop, or any other creative app like Final Cut, Logic, you're gonna appreciate the expansive display and the razor sharp text elements with the UI density. Or maybe you simply just want a color accurate non-Apple option that's 6K without going into XDR pricing because it is expensive and I think this is absolutely worth a look. But if you desire or need true glossy display, the build quality or the aesthetics aren't your thing, it's something for you probably to give a pass. Now, I want to know from you guys watching, if you are shopping for a studio display today, would this make you pause, or is the Apple still the easy choice for you? Let me know down in the comments below where I'll be reading and replying to you guys. Now, if you love desk setups, like I assume that you probably do because that's why you're here, you want to check out this video right here where I go through my favorite accessories for my desk setup. And this video down here, YouTube thinks that you're gonna like that next. And actually, that is my favorite video. You want to watch that. Guys, my name is Mike. Go ahead and click subscribe if you want to get more content like this. And I will talk to you guys in the next one. I'm out of here.